How did I get involved in sun climate relationships? That was 8 years ago when Dutty and I moved to Texel. And a few days later, I met Jan de Leeuw, who was director of this institute. He said, "You know of the sun?" I said, "Yes, I've been working on the sun all my life, more or less." "Ah," he said, "we need someone who studies sun climate relationship. You get an office here in the NIOS." And well, I said, "Thank you, sir." And that's the way I got involved in this business. But it has many implications, of course. Those of you who have been driving over this island in the past few days may have remarked that particularly this southern part of it is not completely flat. It is not a polder. There are gentle hills and gentle slopes over this island. It is dominated by a peak close to the berg, of which the summit ascends to the incredible height of 15 meters above sea level, and which then, for obvious reason, is called the High Mountain, the Hoge Berg. And there is the Hoge Berg, a picture from the 18th century. It is still there. These hills are due to the ice ages. Not the last one, but the last but one. About 130,000 years ago, we had an extended period of quite low temperature, and at that time, the glaciers from the north came down to this area, pushing ground ahead, and these hills of boulder clay are the remnants, remember us to the ice ages so long ago. We are not the only hill, because we have also the hills on Wieringen, Gaasterland, Urk, not to forget, Steenwijk, Koevorden, Hogeveen. And this is a series and a sequence of hills which all show to us up to what point the ice ages came some 130,000 years ago. The ice ages can be explained. They're due to the well-known theory of Milankovitch, 100 years ago about. He says it is not due to variation of the sun, it is the variation of the Earth's orbit. And not only the orbit, also the precessional motion, the angle of the Earth axis is moving, and that causes differences in the illumination of the Earth by the sun, and that causes the ice ages. The theory is okay, and if you calculate the epochs of low temperature, you find it fits exactly to what Milankovitch calculates. But then, if you calculate the amount cooling down, you find it does not work completely. That is because an additional effect plays a part. That is what we call the feedback by water vapor evaporation. The role of water vapor can easily be understood. If the temperature increases, water evaporates, gets into the atmosphere, causes additional greenhouse warming, and because it gets warmer, more water evaporates, gets into the atmosphere, until some saturation is reached, and the reverse for cooling. This has been studied by several people. That is the direct effect of water vapor feedback on the temperature. There are additional effects. The various colors are various authors who have studied it independently, and you see they agree quite well. There is less agreement on the clouds, and indeed, clouds are one of the most difficult aspects of the atmosphere. I'm not an atmospheric scientist, I have to add immediately, but I was earlier this year at a workshop in Bern and about sun-climate relationships, and where I attended the discussions between climatologists about clouds, and at the end of one day they did not find agreement, because clouds are so difficult. The transfer of radiation through a cloud, how do we deal with that? There are thin clouds, there are thick clouds, there are low clouds, high clouds, clouds consisting of water droplets, clouds consisting of ice particles. Well, they did not agree, and that we see also in this great experiment. Here is the effect on the albedo of the Earth. Understandable, when it gets colder, there is more white surface, more reflected. Anyway, the total, the sum is that here. That explains, that effect has to take into account if you want to explain the ice ages. But now I have only dealt with the variation of of temperature on Earth, not due to the Sun, but due to the Earth itself, due to changes of its orbit. The main topic is, what does solar variability do with climate? We all know the Sun is a variable star. We know about the sunspots coming and going, and there are times when there are many sunspots on the Sun, there are times of less sunspots. There is an 10 to 11 year cycle in it. 10 to 11 years after the last maximum, there's again another maximum. The variation, it's always called the 11 years period. It is not exactly 11 years. Indeed, the last century, it was rather 10 years than 11 years. So one also calls it, according to the fellow who found it, Schwabe, apotheker from Germany, who found it in the 18th century. Okay, there is a variability. How does it originate? There's a very difficult problem, and we are not yet completely to agreement. But the machine regulating solar variability is called the solar dynamo, and that is situated in a layer of about 30,000 kilometers thickness, situated about at a depth of 200,000 kilometers below the solar surface. At that level, large convective motions originate, up and downward streaming motions. In addition, there is the interaction with the differential solar rotation. The solar equator is rotating faster angularly around its orbit than the higher level regions, which causes some shear in the interior of the Sun. And these convective motions, in addition to the shearing motions, cause currents, circulating currents, electric currents of an enormous amount, to say at a maximum about 10 to the 12th ampere, 1,000 billion ampere. These electric currents, in turn, cause magnetic fields. And these magnetic fields are strengthened because of the differential rotation. They are taken away by the differential rotation of the Sun, and that causes the fields to become thinner and stronger. The strength increases in the time. And after a number of solar rotations, many solar rotations, tens of solar rotations, the field gets that strong that kink instabilities may originate, kinks causing smaller loops to originate and to detach from the general field. And these loops have a specific lower weight than the surroundings because of their large magnetic energy. These loops originate mainly when the field is stronger than many 10,000s of Gauss, let's say 100,000 Gauss, then which is 300,000 times the strength of the Earth's magnetic field at the poles. Then these fields rise up, and after about 1 month of ascending motions, they arrive at the surface, and there they appear as sunspots. A pair of sunspots, that is what is said here in a few lines. This is a simplified theory of the dynamo. It is more complicated than that. And putting this into a scientific numerical program is extremely difficult. But some people have succeeded. But then these fields arrive at the surface, and there they appear as a pair of sunspots. Not only the sunspots, you see the two pairs at least. These are these loops coming from downward, getting up. There are also these bright points around it, the faculae. These faculae are smaller magnetic fields drawn along upward, and upward they arrive at the surface at have higher magnetic fields. By dissipation, they get rather higher temperatures than the surroundings, to take an average 10,000 degrees or so, and therefore they shine brighter than the surroundings. Their spectrum contains more ultraviolet, to give just one example. This is half of the story of the solar dynamo. But then, in the course of years thereafter, this magnetic field disintegrates and smaller fields originate because they have smaller field strength. They ascend slower, which take more time to reach the surface. In addition, they move more or less parallel to the solar axis by the Coriolis force. And they arrive finally in the polar area. And that way, after the equatorial field related to the toroidal field at maximum strength, a polar field arrives half a solar cycle later. And that causes the, now we are one cycle later, this is altogether, this is about 10 to 11 years what I tried to describe. This is what we see at the poles. Polar bright points, the coronal holes, which are interesting regions where there is no magnetic field and from where gas can escape easily outward. Sources of non-magnetic gas getting out into the into space and more activities. This polar field has often been neglected in sun climate studies. It has nearly always been neglected because it is less compitious. The equatorial field is clearly manifest because of the sunspot, but the polar field is there too. And in addition, the polar field has about the same magnetic flux as the equatorial field. They are comparable, the two. But the exchange, when the equatorial field has maximum strength, the polar field is very weak. When the polar field is strong, the equatorial field is weak. And that is the exotic dance of the two field components. Let us consider that dance in some detail. Here's a diagram which shows the equatorial field. It is, I've drawn it negative and positive because after one 10-year cycle, the polarity changes to the opposite, and that can easily be best be demonstrated by showing this zero line as the reference. So this is one solar cycle of the sunspots. At that time, when it is maximum, when the equatorial field is maximum, the polar field is minimum, and when the polar field is maximum, the equatorial field is zero, and so on. There it goes. This is the last few years because the observations are only available for a rather limited number of polar cycles. This here dates from 1880 till 2010. Very remarkable is what happens in the last few years. Here is the equatorial field going down to its minimum at cycle number 23. We number the cycle, and this is cycle number 20. We would expect it to go through the zero point here in 2008, and that was the general expectation, but that did not happen. It went to practically zero in 2010, and that was the dead sun. The sun was here, it was no longer active. The polar field went to the minimum here, and then we would expect it to go to the zero point here, to its maximum here at this level. And also this stagnates. Dus this curious stagnation in solar activity in the last few years is what is not only intriguing, we find no way to explain it. But now the difficulty, if you want to go on with this study, the magnetic field is only measured quite recently. The equatorial field has been measured since the beginning of the last century, say 1910. First there was Zeeman, the Dutch physicist, who discovered that you could measure magnetic fields through the splitting of spectral lines. And then there was Hale in the United States, who at the Mount Wilson Observatory was the first to measure magnetic fields of sunspots and later of the surroundings of the spots. And that was the beginning of magnetic field measurement. Polar fields are only being measured since about 40 years. Don't forget the instruction I got was to study sun-climate relationships. I got it from Jan de Leeuw. So, what to do if you have only limited information? What you need is a proxy, say a substitute for the activity in earlier years. Now, a proxy for the equatorial field can easily be found. That is the sunspots. More sunspots, more magnetic field. That is quite a good correlation. And we observe sunspots since 1610, when Galilei was the first to use a telescope to look at the sun. Here is the variation of the sunspot number of sunspots since 1610. This peak here is not real. A very recent publication, this has been analyzed on the basis of recordings of long ago, and it was found that there was a wrong interpretation of some earlier recording. The line should go straightly, continuous down to here. This is a period when the sun was really practically dead, no sunspots. It's called the Maunder minimum. Thereafter, the number of sunspots increased steadily. There's a dip around 1810, the Dalton minimum, Maunder minimum, Dalton minimum, and then we got the very high activity center of the last century, which started around 1920 and which reached the top in 1957. This top is really very unique. People like Usoskin say it is the highest peak of the last 10,000 years. Others don't agree, but it is in any case a very, very high peak. So this is the proxy, the substitute for the equatorial magnetic field as seen at the sunspot, the river sunspot. Now the proxy for the polar magnetic field, that is more complicated. It is the minimum of the AA magnetic index. What is the AA geomagnetic index? It is a magnetic field measured simultaneously in London and in Sydney, Australia. This has been done for the first time in 1844, and since that time these data are available. It was found by several authors that the minimum, it is a measure for the maximum polar magnetic field. Can we understand that? Yes, it can be proved. Here are direct observations from the last few decades, where the dots and stars are observations of the maximum polar magnetic field taken at the Stanford and Mount Wilson observatories in the United States. This is a line which happens to go to the zero, as it should do, of course, if it is a good proxy. And we have added this square, which are very recent observations from 2009. Polar field observations are available, and it fits nicely to this line. So this is a good substitute. So now we have two substitutes for the two magnetic fields, the polar and the equatorial. Now we have to compare that with the temperature on Earth. How does the temperature on Earth depends on these two magnetic field components? We, and when I say Bas van Geel from Amsterdam and Sylvia Duo from Argentina and myself, we were the first also to include this polar field because that has mostly been neglected by by climate researchers. Our question was, is the variation of the Earth's surface temperature anyway correlated with solar activity? And if so, can it be explained? Now, this is one diagram showing the increase of temperature on Earth since 1610 to 2000. These lines are drawn by hand. If they are real, we don't know. If these platforms are real, we don't know. But in any case, it again shows a gradual increase of temperature over the centuries. This is one set of data. There are about some, in literature, some about a dozen sets of different independent series of observations. In our study, we have taken the seven most recent ones and have analyzed that. So what we find is that the average increase of temperature correlated with the equatorial field is 0.08 degrees, K means degrees Celsius, degree per century. The polar field 0.04 degree per century, and then is the remaining non-solar component of a 0.05 degree per century. Can we explain that? Well, we can explain, and we'll show that the correlation with the equatorial field. About the non-solar component, it is outside my experience. It is an atmospheric problem. I asked our friends from the Meteorological Office, KNMI, they don't have an answer. I remember, I still in the back of my mind, a paper published by Akasovu from the Arctic Institute of the United States just a year ago, I believe, who said, no, the increase that atmospheric component is the recovery of the Earth from the cool period we had during the Maunder minimum. I asked Akasova, I said, interesting, but can you explain that physically? What is the heat content of the Earth? And what is the characteristic time for losing? He has not yet answered. Maybe he is thinking, but I hope. Anyway, but now let us go to the equatorial component. That is due to the areas around, the facular areas around the sunspots. Here is again a group of sunspots with the facular area. It's a DOT observation, the Dutch Open Telescope at La Palma, which made fantastic observations. And here we have such an example of these observations. We see the sunspot, we also see the facular fields. Temperature about 10,000 degrees, stronger radiation, stronger ultraviolet radiation. Since about 1976, We have started observations from space of the total solar radiation, total solar irradiation. And these are observations that I got from Klaus Fröhlich from Switzerland, who shows the observations since 1970. You see, it goes up with when sunspot number is maximum, then it goes down. Minimum solar activity, again a maximum, minimum, and so on. Very strange is the depression here in 2009, 2010, which is lower than the previous ones. It's an intriguing problem, and with Klaus I have been discussing it. I think it may be due to the general coolness of the outer part of the sun, which causes the atmosphere to become a bit thicker, denser, which may explain this. It is a very small effect. Altogether, this looks impressive, but the effect is very small. If you look at the scale outside, it is less than 1 promille of the total solar radiation. Can that help? Can that explain this temperature variation that we found? Yes, it can, because, let me go first. This is, of course, the intensity is correlated with the number of sunspots. And several authors have tried to, on the basis of the correlation, to extrapolate down to the Maunder minimum and beyond how the total solar radiation would have changed since that time. You see this general increase. This is from Lien, the most recent one. There are also observations by Focal, there are observations by Solanki and others. I have taken the average of these, and then I took the conventional assumption that the relative variation of temperature on Earth is the relative variation of the intensity over 4. That means forgetting about clouds, forgetting about albedo changes of the Earth, the most simple assumption, and then you find that the total the expected temperature variation would be about 0.04 degree per century, which is half what we observe. But then the feedback by water vapor enters, and that explains the other half. So the conclusion is, yes, we can explain the correlation with the equatorial field completely on basis of the variation of the total solar irradiation, to which we add the feedback by water vapor, the strongest greenhouse gas that we know. The other fact, the 0.04, the polar field, that is new. It has not yet been discussed by others, neither by us. We don't know an explanation. There are theories which associate variation of Earth's temperature with particle flow. We know that the particle flow of the Earth is stronger and reducing the magnetic field around the Earth, which causes cosmic ray particles to enter in largest to have a larger flux bombarding the Earth during solar sunspot minimum but during polar maximum. There are theories who associate this cosmic ray bombardment with the origin of clouds. This has been checked by various authors. They find it is insufficient. So no, that. But the question is perhaps what would be the open solar flux? Is open solar flux means the total amount of gas emitted by the sun. Recently, I met a young French scientist called Thierry Dudok de Witt, very nice Dutch name. He even speaks a few words of Dutch. So, and he is involved in a study of the open solar flux, and we had some sort of agreement that when he has finished this, when he has precise data on the open solar flux, we will embark on that. But for the time being, we don't know to explain the polar field, the association, the correlation with the polar field. But if we have done these three components, I forgot to say that this analysis that I mentioned was made for the period 1610 to up to 1970, because 1970 we had this increase of temperature generally associated with the CO2 greenhouse gas, and I excluded that because I wanted to see the effect on the Earth before this strong increase. But now that we have these, we know how these various components influence Earth's temperature, let us now go to up to the recently and subtract from the observations the three components and see what remains. And then I have only to start, I have to start in 1844, because then we have the only, we have good, since that time we have good observations of the polar field and of course of the equatorial field. We see that there are fluctuations of the about the zero line, which are of the order of 1/10 of a degree. These are all perhaps due, at least according to my meteorological colleagues, to the changes you have in the Earth's atmosphere due to all kinds of aspects that we did not take into account. Volcanoes, for instance, and what have you, El Nino, El Niña, etc. Pelican species is this big depression around 1960. Again, my meteorological friends say it is due to little pieces of dust in the atmosphere which seem to be maximum at the time, I don't know. And then there is this increase, and that must be anthropogenic, I think. It goes to about 0.3 degree in 2000. Why did I stop in 2000? Well, we are dealing not with the temperature of this moment, but with this climate. Climate involves integrating and smoothing over a bigger period. We smooth it with a method that Ilya Usoskin and I developed some time ago, smoothing over 20 years period, and that's the reason we had to stop in 2000. It will continue, I guess, but the temperature on Earth flattened down in the last 10 years, so I'm intrigued how this will go on. This, so far, for the variation of the relation between Earth's temperature and solar activity, but now a few words about the future of solar activity. I mentioned already, you have seen the Maunder minimum, and there have been more such sort of minima. And this is the diagram I borrowed from Ilya Usoskin from Finland, where you see the variation of the overall variation of solar activity since 850. The black line is sunspots, it stops in section 10, but there are other indications which show how the solar activity went on in the past. And there, here we see again the very strong Maunder minimum, here the smaller Dalton minimum. At both times the temperature on Earth was lower than average. 1810, Napoleon decided to go to Moscow. He could better have waited for 20 years. But then it was less cold than then. But then going back, you have the Spörer minimum and the Wolf minimum, and here the medieval maximum, but that maximum is far less than the maximum of the last century. And then here the Oort minimum. Ah, about the Oort. I met Cor Schuurmans from the meteorological office, a meteorologist. And Cor said to me, oh, there's Oort minimum. Is certainly named after Jan Oort from Leiden. I said, how can that be? Oort has never been involved in solar matter. But he has a son who is a meteorologist. So Cor asked the son and said, is that Oort minimum named after you? And the young Oort said, no, not at all. I'm not involved. So the only thing I can imagine is that in 1054, the Crab Nebula exploded, and Jan Oort was quite involved in this Crab Nebula identification. And maybe that is the way, but that's the only thing I can imagine. If you have a better solution, I will be happy. So these are then the grand minima, as we call it. Grand minima, grand maximum. Here, the other grand minima. Now, the question is, can we forecast these grand minima? Can we that? No, or yes. And Nigel Weiss from Cambridge says no, because he said the dynamo is a mathematically chaotic system. You cannot forecast what it will do. Dick Patey from the US says yes, because he has developed a very sophisticated computer program to forecast solar activity. And with her programs, he could forecast all Schwabe cycles from the past. But then Dick Patey tried also, quite a number of years ago already, to forecast solar activity for the next Schwabe cycle, for the next few years. And she failed completely, showing that something is going on in the last few years. What is going on? Sylvia Duho and I have found, but completely empirical, that you make a phase diagram where you plot the polar field against the equatorial field. And then the solar activity is making lines through the diagram. There is one point which we have baptize the transition point. When solar activity goes to that point, a new episode is going to start. For completely empirical, we have not yet an explanation. So this is then this phase diagram. Here the polar field, there the equatorial field. And let us start in 1844, because then we had the first polar observation. There it goes, there it goes, there it goes, there it goes. Yep, very sick. And there it was in 1924, through the transition point, the star here. Then, indeed, a new phase started, new episode started. The recent grand maximum, there it goes. And in 2009, it was again in the same place. So I expect that we have now entered, we are now at the point of entering, or have just recently entered, a new phase, a new grand episode. And I guess it will be a sort of a deep minimum, maybe a Maunder-type minimum. If it would become a Maunder-type minimum, that is for the future, then what would be the consequence on temperature? That with the results that I showed just a few minutes ago, we are able to explain, to forecast what the influence of temperature, it would cause a little decrease of the temperature. But a decrease, a relative decrease, a decrease so added to or subtracted from the otherwise expected heating or not. We calculated a decrease of about 0.4 degrees. I saw a few other publications. One gave 0.3, another 0.45, so it is about of the same order. That should be subtracted from the otherwise expected atmospheric or anthropogenic temperature variation during a Maunder-type minimum. It's for the future, and we don't know yet. But now the short-term variation. How about the next solar cycle? I have shown you a previous solar cycle. The next solar cycle was expected to start have its maximum in 2012. That's what we thought some 5-6 years ago when the sun entered into its minimum, but then it stayed in the minimum, and that is an indication that the next maximum will be pretty low. There is this is a diagram that they borrowed from Mike Lockwood from UK. This shows the minimum of solar, this is the years from up to 2011, from 2002. He brought together 9 indicators for solar activity. If it is cosmic ray, it is the maximum. If it is solar irradiation, it is minimum. And you see, the first minimum were reached in 2008, but the last minimum was reached in 2010. So it's a very, very extended minimum. Very remarkable, you had never had before. I found also that the 3 early minima are all related to the equatorial magnetic field. The late minima are related to the polar magnetic field. So there is some hint as to the physical interpretation. Might be interesting to study that, has not yet been done. So this is this extraordinary solar minimum of the last few years. And now there is a relation between the that already found by Ohl in 1960s, he says the strength of the preceding a minimum value is related to the strength of the following solar maximum value. And we have taken the data of the last few cycles. There they are. That gives a straight line. And by extrapolating that, we found in 2009 that the solar activity, the next maximum solar activity, would be extremely low. Sunspot number smaller than 80, of the order of 70. And with the observation, with the data of the Earth's magnetic field from quite the most recent one, 2010, we find even it should be between these two triangles. This is about solar activity 60, which is very low, let's say. It is measured in certain quantities, but the solar activity will be extremely low, and it will not happen in 2012. We rather expect it in 2013, 2014. But that we have only 3 years to wait, and then we know for sure. So I hope to wait that long. This is then the picture of solar activity since 1600 till 2000. Here we see the stars are the maxima of sunspot numbers, the maxima of the various Schwabe cycles. You see them, they are practically zero during the period. This star is not real, it should be practically zero, as I told before. And then it went up, and 1724 we had a period of quite regular variations, and then 24, the big maximum of the last century started, and now we expect that in 2013 it will be here about. Yeah, that is the future. Two things to wait. A low maximum of solar activity in 2013, I guess, maybe 2014, and followed by a deep minimum that may last the whole rest of the century. We don't know. Thank you.
So in the recent literature, there has been quite a number of studies on the meridional flow, which we can compare with kind of the conveyor belt in our own ocean, which transports the magnetic flux from the sunspots to the poles. So could this be the physics, like the missing link between your equatorial field and polar field, and can we learn why this is going on from those studies?
I did not touch the meridian flow, but it is there, of course, and it does influence the solar magnetic field. Dirk Callebaut, who's sitting here, found a number of years ago that in subsequent solar cycles, the average latitude of sunspots went lower and lower, closer and closer to the equator. And extrapolating that, you find that it has disappeared around 2030. Am I right, Dirk? I think so, more or less, huh? Yeah. Okay. He doesn't protest.
The guess was that it was going to be maybe in this cycle or maybe next cycle.
Yeah.
That we could not predict it precisely. It was work by Makarov and myself, and I was rather for that it was going to be now. Makarov felt.
But anyway, the answer to your question is meridian flow must be included in all the in the scientific program for forecasting solar activity, surely. Yeah.